Hello there, everybody. This is the Brave Hylian, and I'm back with more Let's Play The Legend of Zelda, A Link to the Past. In the last episode, we beat the first dungeon, and now we're going to take off the fourth dungeon. Yes, we'll take it off, and we'll also take it on. Taking on the fourth dungeon, that is what we're doing. Okay, so this was intended to be the fourth dungeon in the Dark World. I, however, am doing it as my second dungeon in the Dark World, so... Yes, you might normally have more hearts when you come to this dungeon. I'm not really sure. This first part basically is made up of a room, sort of a maze. There are four rooms, and the only thing you have to do is go to this part of the first room. This right here is the big key. Once you have that, that's all you need from this four-room labyrinth kind of thing. So once you have that, you can go pretty much straight to the northeasternmost corner of the maze. If that guy didn't take away my shooty beamy, that would be great. So when you get up to the northeast corner, that's where the door is, and you're pretty much done with this area. It has a lot of enemies in it, it's confusing, there's a map and the compass in there. I don't care, I'm not really gonna mess with it. Anyway, here's a key, and shoot. I think that may end up being the only key that you actually need in the dungeon at all, so that's cool. This dungeon can be done very quickly. We're about probably a minute and a half into the video, and I have the big key and making tracks towards the end. So, like I said, can you do this dungeon very early, it is actually really easy, and I can see how it might be difficult if you don't know what you're doing, as with almost anything, but, yeah, it's not hard. The boss can be a little difficult, he does quite a bit of damage to you, but as long as you damage him as much as he's damaging you, that's really all you need to do. Because he will die sooner than you will if you just keep spamming your sword at him. Dude, don't run into me, you gecko shit. Not that I had my shooty beamy or anything already, but I didn't need it back, but seriously, dude, just go away. So the only thing we need to do here is get out a bomb and blow up this thing, and why we need to do that will become evident later, but suffice it to say, we need to do it. So yeah, if you come to the house that has the green roof in the light world, the guy there will tell you a story about a blind thief who used to, I guess, live in that house. I guess the idea is that that thief is pretty much the boss of this dungeon. Somehow is one of Ganondorf's servants or something, or was corrupted by Ganondorf or whatever. But yeah, if I could get this anti-fairy, that would be great. There we go. Okay. Ow. Well, actually, he didn't hit me. I don't know why I'm saying ow. And I don't know why I have, like, a monotone voice all of a sudden. Wow, that's annoying. Okay. So, yeah. Now that we have Shooty Beamy back, we can do that. And, yeah, it's... Like I said, this dungeon, pretty darn easy. There's one slightly thing that you may find slightly confusing. In just a moment here, but oh shoot, I need to go over there first. Darn. I guess what the game wants you to think is that when you get to this point, you've found the sage, I guess, but I don't know, I never really thought of that girl as like the one that you were supposed to save, or one of the maidens, I guess, is what they want you to think. But you've only ever met them in a crystal, so it doesn't make sense that Ganon would not put them in a crystal. So, I don't know, I never really fell for that. I mean, not that I knew exactly what to do the first time I ever played it, but it's... I don't know, it's pretty obvious when you look at it what you gotta do. And the item we just picked up allows us to lift stones that were heavier than the ones that we lifted before. And it's not like we've been, you know, trying to lift all these really heavy stones and haven't been able to do it at any point during this playthrough, but it will allow us to get one upgrade that is very nice and I'm very much looking forward to. So anyway, we're just about done with this dungeon. The only thing left to do is go into this room If you didn't blow out the ceiling above you, there would be no light, and then this boss battle wouldn't happen. But anyway, the girl turns into this boss, who can be a little bit annoying with his own shooty beamy. You know, we don't necessarily have to be the only ones that have shooty beamy, but luckily this shield that we got can repel most of that crap, as long as we're facing in the right direction. And like I said, this guy can definitely do some damage, but as long as you keep up with him, it's totally cool. He shouldn't really give you any problems. And the boss being difficult is really one of the only reasons you wouldn't do the fourth dungeon before, you know, the second or the third, but I think doing it first is definitely well worth it considering the sword upgrade that we can now get from beating the fourth dungeon. So we will sit here and very excitedly, with bated breath, anticipate what this girl is going to say to us. I never noticed how her dress that she's wearing is like really red. That's actually kind of cool. I guess back in the day, playing it on the SNES, it was kind of, you couldn't really see it as well as I can see it right now. That's why I noticed Link's pink hair recently. There's a lot of cool things, a lot of cool graphical things that didn't really make it to the final product, but you can definitely tell from some of these ROMs that they intended to put this kind of stuff in the game. So anyway, now that we've got that palace finished, or that dungeon finished, or whatever it is, we can go down here and lift this rock right here and find Slippy, who has lost his partner. And of course, Slippy can't survive without his life partner, so we've got to go take him back to his life partner. And he is actually the other, if we had come here earlier, there would have been a guy, a swordsmith, basically a blacksmith, I guess you could call it, and he's missing his partner. So this is that guy's partner, and we're bringing him back, so that's nice. And yes, they're very happy now. Now they can just have all the gay sex they want. And anytime I can make that happen, it's cool. So, yeah. And they offer to temper your sword, which is really nice. So, something else you can do on this little square, I guess is what it is, or this acre, I suppose, if we were in Animal Crossing. You can fall down this well, and you don't need your sword to do this, which is why I'm doing it right now. And you end up in this hole. And you end up at this weird, freaky altar. If you spray magic powder on it, this guy will come out, this bat. And this guy's actually really funny. He says, "Hey, blast you for waking me from my deep, dark sleep. I mean, thanks a lot, sir. But now I'll get my revenge on you. Get ready for it. Is that okay with you, sir?" I don't know why, that's hilarious. "I laugh at your misfortune. Now your magic power will drop by one half. Do your best, even though I'm sure it won't be enough." Yeah, that guy's hilarious. Anyway, what he meant by "your magic power will drop by one half" is whenever you use magic, you now consume one half of what you would have consumed before. So that's really nice. It's like, have you ever woken up from like a nap or something and then just been really confused and had conflicting feelings? I mean, don't even act like you haven't, because you have. You know you have. So anyway, as with the other thing that I can't remember what it was right now, if you go off the screen, that's right, it was the witch. If you go off the screen, that's how they know pretty much that you've allowed time to pass. So come back in here and you get your tempered sword. This is why I did the fourth dungeon as soon as I could, because that is what you have to do to get the tempered sword, and it's a really good item to have, especially against the bosses in the second and third palaces. It's a really useful thing. So anyway, when we go back to the Dark World and we basically take a bunch of time and pound all these stakes into the ground. I always thought these stakes actually looked really cool. They look like, I don't know, purple is my favorite color, and it always was, and I just think purple things are cool, and since these stakes are like kind of a purplish, pinkish sort of color, I think it's awesome. So anyway, when you do all that, this cave opens up and we get a heart piece, so that's cool. And I'm thinking that this is probably going to be the best time to get that really pain in the ass heart piece that I was talking about not too long ago. I guess that was in the last video by now, but anyway. Now that we have the second level power glove, or the Titan's Mitt as it were, we can get up back to the village anytime we want really easily. So what I'm gonna do is come over here and we're gonna play the digging game, which is easily one of the worst things for a speedrunner in this game, because finding the heart piece in this is like a total crapshoot. There's just nothing. What is in the ground here is like totally random, so there's like nothing basically that you can do to control the outcome of this, and I usually get more rupees than this. Usually you can actually make a lot of money digging in this game. It's really weird that I haven't found any big ones. There we go. If I don't get 80 back, this is gonna be bad. So I'm not sure. I better find a red one real quick. There we go. Oh my god, I found the heart piece. Holy shit. At the last second. Oh my god, that is so awesome. Thank you. Gods of Zelda, Nehru, Din, and Feror, thank you so much for allowing me to find that heart piece on the first try. Now, why I can't do that on every speedrun that I've ever done, I don't know. I've had times where I've been doing a speedrun, and I've had to do that digging game about 10 or 12 times before, and it takes like 45 seconds to do each one. 45 seconds to a minute, which doesn't seem like that long, but if you sit there and do that game for 10 minutes and you know there's a heart piece in there somewhere and you can't find it, it gets really frustrating. So yeah, I am so happy that I got that. Why I got that right now when I don't really care about time and I can't get it on any of my speedruns, I don't really know, but I guess I'll celebrate having done it anyway. So there's 300 rupees right there, by the way, in case you need rupees. That was my backup plan for if I ran out of rupees at that digging game. I don't think I needed them for anything, but since I have some time at the end of this episode and I'm not gonna get to start the next dungeon, I figured I might as well just go ahead and get it over with. So now we definitely won't have to worry about rupees anymore, since we've played both of the mini games that cost money for a heart piece, so that's really good. And you know what? Since I have some extra time, I'm actually gonna go and grab a couple of things that it would take a while to do. They're kind of out of the way heart pieces that there's not really a convenient time to really go get them, so I'm gonna do them now. Yeah. This area up here, like by the sanctuary in the Dark World, you don't really come up here all that often, so any time that you can really make to come out of your way and get this stuff is a good time to do it, pretty much. And it's much easier if you don't have the Titan's Mitt at the time. You have to like go into the Light World and then warp back and then warp back to the Dark World. It's kind of a pain in the ass, but anyway, when we go in here, we will not be getting a heart piece, actually. Well, no, this one is a heart piece. I got confused there for a second. Anyway. Yeah, so bomb this wall out. And yay, heart piece. That's great. So now that we have three, I will definitely be going ahead to find another one before we get out of here. Oh, and I know exactly which one we can get. What we're gonna do actually is dash against this, kill the ghost, and we're going to get a very useful little item that will be helpful. And it is the magic cape. You are invisible when you wear it. So, you actually are invisible, which also in turn makes you invincible. So it's definitely a really good item to have. Now, I wish I hadn't left my Dark World warp up there, because now I'm gonna have to find another one to get the heart piece that I wanted to get, and that's a pain in the ass. But never mind, I actually won't have to do that, because I can just go ahead and get this one right here. Yeah, I can't believe I haven't actually got this one yet. This is always one of the ones that I used to get first when I was a kid. But if you dash against this pile of rocks right here, you can, well, there you go. You can go down there, and we have a heart piece right here. So yeah, they're just everywhere. So now that we have 13 hearts, we will get 5 more hearts containers from beating bosses. So I guess that means we have 8 heart pieces left to find. That's doing pretty well. But anyway, this is going to be the end of this episode of Let's Play The Legend of Zelda, A Link to the Past. This has been the Brave Hylian. Thank you all so much for watching. Have a great day. and I will see you guys next time. Bye now.